Okay, can. Okay, so if you have not been living under the rock recently, right, you probably have heard about these incidents, right? So there are two major plane crashes in the last 6 months. Okay, so the common thing about these two crashes is that they are using the same plane. This plane here, Boeing 737 MAX 8. And thing is, this is a very new model, you know. It's not like a 10 years or 20 years old. It's only a 2 or 3 years old only, you know. So of course, it was bad. Aviation authorities decided to ground this plane worldwide, and it's still grounded today. So the key suspicion of what caused this crash, right, was linked to this particular system called this MCS, Maneuvering Characteristic Augmentation System. No need to read first, I'll go through that later. Okay, so basically this system did something wrong, okay? Yeah. So this question came up. Was this a poor software solution to a hardware design flaw? Okay, I'll try to answer them. But before that, right, I'll go through several foundational knowledge, because this picture here, right, assumes actually that you know a lot of foundational stuff, which I think not everyone knows. So I'll go through some of the key aerodynamic and aviation terms before finally going to the how this problem came about, and then what this MCAS system did, and my conclusion. Okay, so I'll start with the basics first, like how does an aircraft like fly, right? You all seen a picture like this before? Okay, very simple. There's a curve, the top part is curved, right? Rather it's more curved than the bottom part. So the air flows faster above the top of the wing. When air flows faster, the pressure drops. And since there's a difference in pressure between the top and bottom, right, the wing goes up. Okay, there's a resultant force in upwards. Okay, so now I'll introduce to you an aeronautical term called stall. Stall is not like your car engine stall. Different. Car engine stall is your engine stall. So in aerodynamic, the stall doesn't mean that the airplane engine stall. It means that the lift effectiveness of the wing has dropped too low. Okay? So you can see the airflow, right? Previously, right, it's a very smooth airflow, like that. In a stall, this is what the airflow will look like. Very disrupted. So because of this disruption, right, the wing is not able to generate sufficient lift. The technical definition of a stall is that the angle of attack of a wing exceeds a critical angle, okay, which I'll explain. Okay, so an angle of attack of a wing is the angle between the chord line, the wing, and the relative wing. So a chord line is just an imaginary line you draw from the leading edge to the trailing edge. Okay, and the relative wing is the wing that the aircraft is moving towards. Okay, so there is a particular angle to this. Okay, so this angle, the greater the angle, there will be more lift, but it's only up to a certain point, which is called the critical angle. So you can see this graph here, right? As you increase the angle of attack, right? Plane here, right? So as you do this, right, the wing will generate more lift, but only up to a certain point. So at this particular critical angle of attack, let's say this is the critical angle of attack, if I exceed it, right, the lift will drop very drastically, and the whole plane will just sink really. And this is called the stall. Okay? So of course I'll try to show example. So this is what the MCAS is trying to counter is something called power on stall. So when the engine is at full power at takeoff, and then it's very high pitch, it stalls. Okay, I'll show you an actual video. And this video is mine. In case y'all don't know, I'm actually a private pilot. So this was in my stall training in aircraft checkout flight on Sunday at Seletar Flying Club. So in this video is how a power on stall is done. So this is my instructor over there.
Okay, so now power on stall. Okay, so
power on stall. Okay, flaps.
So I'm slowing down the aircraft very slow to 55 knots, which is
your takeoff speed. Your rotation speed 55, yeah. And then go full power. Alright. And the altitude, if not, you won't do a session.
You can see I'm actually raising the nose up.
55, right?
Alright. The sound is so on.
That's full power, full stall, right?
You can see how high the aircraft is picking up already. On this side.
Okay,
so the aircraft is shaking.
Once you do buffeting, you can recover, right? Okay. Don't go into secondary storm. Okay?
Okay. So, even in private pilot, we also train for this. Train for this thing. Okay. Okay, so for modern aircraft, there's something called angle of attack sensor. So it's actually this particular mini wing, a rotatable wing that is on outside the aircraft. And then it will pipe the data over to the pilot who will see in the display. For example, you can see your 5.2. So this is a 5.2 degrees angle of attack. Okay, so the pilot can see. Okay, so now I come to another thing which is called the qualifications for a pilot. Okay, so pilots, there are many qualifications like this, student, private, commercial, and all these things. And these are the ratings. So this one means what I can do with the license. Ratings means what kind of planes the pilot can fly. The thing is, there's something called a jet type rating. So a jet type rating means that a pilot must go through specific training before he can fly a particular plane. For example, Boeing 737, you need to go through specific training to fly a Boeing 737. And each jet rating, like, typically takes $50,000 to $100,000 of training costs. Expensive, huh? And then not only that, right? The pilot has to go through annual test, right? To make sure that the pilot is still proficient. Very expensive. Okay? So with that, right, I'll come over to the history of the Boeing 737. Right? Everything starts from the past. So, the Boeing 737 entered service in 1967, first model. And they had this particular requirement, right? You had to fly very short routes. It had to be low to the ground because of last time, right, airports are not as advanced as today. And it's designed to fly to small airports where they don't have a lot of facility. So it means that it has to be low to the ground, so the person loading the luggage is easier. You know, you lift the luggage so high. Another thing is that it's easier to inspect the engine. Engine lower to the ground is easy for the mechanic to check for problems. Okay? Okay, so now, of course, Boeing, they don't rest on their laurels. They will improve. So they brought another second generation model called the Boeing 737 Classic. Okay, so this was introduced in 1984. They had a larger engine. It's called a high bypass CFM56. Okay, so what it mean by high bypass engine, right? Is that the engine is that in essence, right, can move more air for the same amount of fuel. Okay, so let's take a look at this low bypass, right? Means that all the exhaust, whatever comes out of the engine, it comes in through this small section here, right? So now let's look at low bypass engine. So the fuel is burned here, but in addition to that, it drives a fan which also moves air along the outside of the engine, right? This part. And a super high bypass engine, right? They move even more air outside. So they have something called a bypass ratio. For example, let's say the ratio of 10 to 1, right? It means that for every 1 kg of air that moves in the center, 10 kg moves outside. So basically it means that you burn this same amount of fuel, right? Or a slightly more amount of fuel, you can actually move a lot more air. So you generate much more thrust. So the efficiency of generally increases with the bypass ratio. Okay? So now let's take a look at the comparison. The first gen and second gen 737. You can see the engine, the new engine is bigger, right? So it's 1.5 meters versus 1.25 meters diameter. And the bypass ratio is 6 to 1. Right? That means they move 1 kg at the center is equal to moving 6 kg outside. It's much more efficient. Of course, the story doesn't end there. They have a third generation one. It's just another engine and even better aircraft. Okay, this one is not going. Then in 2010, right, Airbus came in with a competitive offering. This Airbus A320neo stands for new engine option. They had this this engine with a better bypass ratio, 11 to 1. This is 6 to 1. So even this engine is even more fuel efficient, right? So of course Boeing must fight back, right? If not, they will lose back their customers to this particular plane. Okay? So now they had a problem because the Boeing 737, due to its long history, right, is very low to the ground. You can see the comparison, like Airbus A320 is how much higher compared to this. So they got problem fitting the engine in. You see, for this particular, even a second gen, right, they purposely make this bottle flatter, right? You have to make it flat because if it's a pure circle, right, you it's too close to the ground already. But okay. So they had two choices. They either have to redesign a new plane to make the plane taller. But the problem is if that happens, right, it's a new aircraft type rating. It means airlines have to train all their pilots again, they pay $50,000 to $100,000 per pilot, you know. to train them to fly this new plane. Or they can make minimal changes and make this new plane behave like the old one. So, I mean the choice is obvious. Like, you all read the news, it's obvious they pick the second choice. And the second choice resulted in the Boeing 737 MAX series. So it was announced shortly after Airbus, 1 year later. And they use an engine of 921. Not as good as the Airbus one, but still much better than the 737 third gen. Okay? So you can see the comparison. 737, this 800 series is the third gen, MAX is the fourth gen. You can see what they do. So they make minimal design changes, which means the whole plane, right, largely is still the same. It's still the same height from the ground. But the engine is so much bigger because of the high bypass ratio. So no choice, right? They have to move the plane, move the engine forward and up. But this has consequences, right? When you move the engine forward and up, right, your engine thrust, right, is now further in front of the aircraft. So in aircraft, there's something called the center of gravity. In case you all forget, center of gravity is where it's a point where it's equal to the entire, when the force acting on the aircraft is equal to acting around that point. Okay, so the center of gravity of the aircraft usually is around here, the wing line. Obviously, yeah, because the wing will leave the center of gravity, right? So now this engine is further away. So when something is further away from the center of gravity, the moment increases. So when it increases the moment means, right, that it tends to have, like, moment times the force, right? So the moment is higher. So it has more influence on the aircraft aerodynamics. Another thing is that when you move forward, right, you have increased surface area here. It's like a smaller wing. But this has an impact. It means that there's more lift on this section. So in the past, there's no lift here. Suddenly got lift here. So you have more, it pulls the aircraft up here, right? So now it causes something called a greater pitch up tendency. When your aircraft is slow and high power, right, your thrust is pushing the plane up. Then plus, here you have an extra lifting force. So all add up, you tend to pitch up more. So the problem is, right, this behaves like different aircraft. So to make the aircraft behave like the old aircraft, they have to put a software fix there to counter this thing, right? So if let's say they detect that the aircraft is going to pitch up too high, right, the computer will force the nose down. Okay? So the thing is, this on paper is okay, it's not wrong, but it suffers on the poor implementation, right? Only one or two sensors are used. So if the sensors spoil, then the computer cannot do its work properly already. Another one is that this one, right, angle attack indicator, right, supposed to be there, but they make it optional. You need to pay money, the airlines will pay Boeing to install that feature. And they never pay, they don't have one, never install, the pilot don't know. Then another one is that, even if you don't have this, right, there's something, another feature called the angle of attack sensor disagree alert. It means that if one of the sensors spoil, let's say one sensor on the left side is spoiled, right, if the right side is correct, right, the computer of course doesn't know, but it knows that one of the sensors reading different from the other, means something's not right already. Then they should alert the pilot already, right? But this feature is optional also. So without this, the pilot don't know what happened, right? Okay, another one is that there was no training to recognize that this thing has failed and how to override it. Because if this aircraft is supposed to behave like the previous plane, right, it's not supposed to have this MCA system, right? On paper, this thing shouldn't actually be invisible, so pilots should not be trained for it, right? They're hiding it from the regulator, okay? But there's actually a way to do it, so if they want to override this system, it's something called an electric trim. So electric trim, this thing exists even on small aircraft. The one that I fly, the Piper and Cessna, also has this. So you just move this, you move the trim forward and backward. Then there's something called a manual trim control, also can turn the wheel. Another one is a stabilizer trim cutout, means that because the MCAS adjusts the trim of the back, you can just totally cut power to that. So the MCAS cannot even do anything. Three different ways to do it. But if the pilots are not trained, then they don't know that this is what you should do. Okay? So there is a short-term fix, right? Short-term fix means that, now they will have a software update to take reading from both sensors. Okay? No repeated pitch-down event. So let's say if the aircraft pitch down already and the pilot override, right? The system will know, okay, maybe the pilot know what they're doing. They're not going to try to repeatedly force the nose down. Okay? They allow the pilot to override it. In the past, right, the pilot cannot even override it. Right? Or rather, it cannot override easily. Okay? Another one is that with more pilot training, you tell the pilot that this system exists, in case this thing happens, what you should do. The long-term recommendations made by others is that the FAA should not let Boeing self-certify the aircraft. Because Okay, the root cause because FAA is the organization, the aviation authority in US. So they certify planes. Okay, so I think they lack of resources, they tell Boeing, okay, you just check yourself. Go. And then perhaps Boeing should build a new plane. Shouldn't like stack on all these extra features like to make the old plane, new plane behave like the old one. Okay, so in case you're wondering, right, this system is not new. It already exists in like fighter aircraft. So it started with the F-15, the first one to have this particular feature. Because these aircraft, they are called not aerodynamically stable. So it's not possible for a human to control them stick and rudder. So they must some computer right to keep it stable. So all these bombers, stealth bombers. Okay. The first one to adopt it is not Boeing's Airbus, A320. Yeah. So Airbus planes are generally much more automated than Boeing. So this MCS system, people complain why Boeing doing it. Actually, Airbus doesn't have something like that. Okay. So the conclusion is that, is this a poor software solution to hardware design flaw? In my opinion, I don't think this is the case. You shouldn't see software and hardware separate. This software and hardware, they come together, you should treat them as a single system. Okay? Boeing had good intentions. I don't think every engineer set up to kill people, right? So they wanted the airlines to save cost and time. So airlines don't want to train their pilots. And then, if everything is at 737, like for example, this particular airline in US called Southwest Airlines, all their planes are 737. It's easy, it means the pilot train one time can fly everything already. Right? If you have 737 and another model, then the pilot has to train here, train there. And not only that, when they renew the license, they need to renew two different planes. Troublesome. Then FAA did not verify implementation. So this is bad. Okay? So the regulator shouldn't be like outsourcing their checks to the company that they are regulating. Then what for?
Airbus can be benefit as well.
I'm not sure. Different. Airbus is more than... Okay, FAA actually regulates a lot of planes. But maybe they give special treatment to Boeing because they're a US company. Okay. So, I don't know how much time left. I think I've got extra time. Any questions you all can ask?
So, what's the outcome?
It's still grounded. Okay, the final report is not out. So, it's not confirmed that the MCA system is the fault. Where's the picture? Yeah, it's not confirmed, but it's highly suspected. This is the case.
So the Lion Air one that cracked, the same thing as I heard, the first time when the problem came out, the pilot override the system, he shut down the system.
The pilot in the passengers. Yeah.
They tried to shut down but failed to...
They managed to shut down.
But too late.
So
the one before the Lion Air incident,
it's the same aircraft but different crew.
The
passenger to shut it down.
Possible. Yeah. I think I heard about that. They managed to shut down, but the information not passed over to the next pilot for this. Any questions for this? Any more questions?
Is the virtual horizon based on the AOA indicator?
No. Okay, AOA, right? Okay, let me get to that.
So your virtual horizon and AOA are two separate things. Because of your...
Okay. Virtual horizon is with respect to the ground. Because it's a gyro driven, it is still gravity. When the aircraft moves right, the virtual horizon stays still. Angle of attack right can vary regardless of what the aircraft, where the aircraft is pointing to. Because if aircraft can stall even when it's direct to the ground, facing direct to the ground. It's because it's respect to the relative wind.
If this was the case to them, the pilot would have known that it was actually flying downwards towards the ground before he actually
cracked. The pilot definitely knows
it's
flying towards the ground.
So it's not like it's an issue of confusion where the pilot didn't know that he was flying towards the ground.
No, the confusion is why the aircraft keep forcing him down, why the computer keep forcing him. I think that's the confusion. Even when they pull up, the computer never release control. Because they didn't know this system existed. And another thing is that Boeing aircraft usually don't have much automation compared to Airbus. Right? So the computer shouldn't be doing so much.
So this is a very big question. It's like even you say Boeing is not have more manual control, so why are they still not able to override this automatic issue?
Okay, I would say
that the pilot finds something to pull out, but yes. Why the machine does otherwise?
Okay, why the engineers forced down, right? Because it's called flight envelope protection. Because the engineers, when they design the plane, they think that they know better. The pilot sometimes needs to be protected from themselves. And certain times it's true. On Airbus planes, right, sometimes if you force the aircraft up into the stall, right, the computer will bring down the nose. So this is where the engineers think that they know much better than the pilots, which is wrong, really.
But it's happening everywhere in the market.
Yeah.
When, you know, when engineers develop stuff for users and totally ignore users' input.
They think they know better, they're the best.
It's just the wrong that provided the fact that the sensor starts to work, your enough sensor working, and then the machine, right, does receive all the correct angular information and sufficient enough to execute the action.
Yeah, true. So the assumption is wrong. They assume that the attack sensor always works. With more it fails, then everything happens.
Of course, there's always a conspiracy theory of everything is supplied by wires so that in case of emergency, the government can take over the plane.
It's also not very sure that I think there will be real evidence that there have been some political move this year or business.
Okay, I think I shall not comment on that.
I think there's too much conspiracy theory out there, so I think better not.
Okay, anymore? Any questions? I think how much recording time there?
21.
Okay, can then I stop lah. Okay, thanks.